See. Over to you, sir.
Yeah, thank you, and good morning to you all. It's great to be part of this workshop by the Department of Medicine, and I'm thankful to Dr. Tambu and other faculty of medicine for this opportunity. So today I'm supposed to talk on evidence for transcatheter aortic valve implantation, or TAVI as is popularly known as. So my aim for the talk today would be to give you a flavor of what a TAVI procedure is and what are our experience with TAVI at CMC. So TAVI is essentially is a catheter-based treatment for treating patients with severe aortic stenosis. Mostly it's done in elderly patients in whom the common cause of stenosis is age-related degeneration. Now, definition of aortic stenosis severity is by echocardiography. The criteria for significance is valve area less than 1 and a mean gradient more than 40. So it's good to know that in addition to the usual high grade in classical AS, there are actually two more hemodynamic subsets of AS. These are low flow, low grade in AS with reduced LV function as well as normal LV function. So why do we need TAVI? We need TAVI because 30% of patients with AS do not undergo surgery. And these patients, half of them die by 2 years. So as you can see in the graph, medical management has no role in the treatment of severe aortic stenosis. Now, the reason why they don't get surgery is that these patients have multiple comorbidities, and as the age increases, the risk factors also increases and the surgery becomes more complicated. And there are other factors such as patient preferences, etc. So all patients with AS can be classified into several risk groups based on the risk scores which are developed by surgeons, which can be graded from low to prohibitive surgical risk. And as you can see, about 25 to 30% of these patients are at high risk or are even inoperable. These are the patients who are going to benefit from this procedure. So how is TAVI different from a surgical valve replacement? TAVI is a minimally invasive procedure done under local anesthesia. Surgery requires general anesthesia, needs a thoracotomy. A lot of personnel are involved. For TAVI, you need only two operators and a technician. The procedure time is quite short. The hospital stay as well as the ICU stay is also quite less with TAVI. All TAVI valves are bioprosthetic valves, which means they're tissue valves, which means that they don't require long-term anticoagulation. And here on the right, you can see a picture of a transcatheter valve. Essentially, has three parts. It's got this metallic frame. It's got a tissue valve leaflet, which is usually made of bovine or porcine pericardium. And it's also got this external and internal sealing skirt, which can reduce paravalvular leaks. So these are some of the examples of transcatheter valves. All of these valves can be classified as two groups, a balloon expandable valve or a self-expanding valve based on the mode of deployment. On the left, you see a balloon expandable valve being deployed. This valve is crimped onto a balloon and deployed by inflating the balloon. On the right, you see a self-expanding valve. This is constrained within a catheter and deployed by releasing the catheter backwards. So now we have an Indian valve with us, which is known as MyVal, and which is almost as good as the valve which is available abroad. And this is how the valves look under fluoroscopy. Again, two prototypes, balloon expandable valve, self-expandable valve. The technology is the same, but there are several valves. So how is this procedure performed? In more than 95% of patients, this is a true percutaneous procedure, which means that you don't require any cut down or any surgery. Usually done through transfemoral access. You access the femoral artery, and that's how you do it. But in some patients, the femoral artery is hostile, which means there are a lot of calcification or a lot of tortuosity. Then you can't do this procedure through the transfemoral route. In these patients, you use other alternative accesses, like you could you choose a transapical approach, transaortic, transcarotid, and even transsubclavian. In some patients, we also attempted a transcaval aortic access, which means that you make a communication between the IVC and the aorta and then deploy the valve through this device, through this access. So this is essentially a cartoon of how a TAVI is being done. To me, there are actually three important steps or the pressure points for doing a TAVI. One is crossing the valve. It can be quite challenging because these valves are quite calcified and heavily stenosed. And the second one is actual placement of the valve. If you're not able to place the valve correctly across the annulus, you're going to have bad results. And the third final problem is to close the valvular vascular access. For the vascular access, we introduce a sheath which is about 8 millimeter in diameter, and this is also closed percutaneously. So here in this cartoon, you can see that this is now we introduced a sheath through which a balloon dilatation of the valve was initially performed. Now we're going to take the valve. Valve is being manipulated in the descending aorta. And now it's taken across the annulus. And this is a balloon expandable valve. This valve is deployed by just inflating the balloon. And inflation of this valve is done at rapid pacing. You pace the heart at about 200 beats per minute so that your cardiac output drops and the valve remains stable across the aorta. So fluoroscopically, when we work, this looks like it. First, you take a vascular access. You do an aortic root angiogram to visualize the anatomy and delineate the level of deployment of the valve. Cross the valve with a smaller wire. Place a stiff wire in the ventricle. Take the valve across the arch and then place the valve in the correct position. And then after deployment in the final angiogram, you can see the dye only in the aorta with no back leakage of dye into the ventricle, which means that the valve is functioning quite well. So for the vascular access closure, we have several technologies. We use proglides. So it's essentially a totally percutaneous procedure. So where do we stand now with TAVI? So I like to call TAVI a disruptive technology. Why disruptive? Because it has changed the current standard of practice. It used to be surgical aortic valve replacement. And now with the evidence which we have over the last 10 or so years, the gold standard for severe aortic stenosis in high risk or intermediate risk patients, number of TAVI procedures have gone up considerably. It's also the case in our setting as well. So how do we get this? How do we reach here? We got to this position by gradually building up on the evidence. We got a lot of RCTs in all levels of risk, high risk, intermediate risk, and now we have data for even for the low risk population. So all the data was built up on high risk, initially on high risk patients. These were the initial trial, the PARTNER 1A and the CoreValve pivotal trial shows that the TAVI is either equivalent or superior to surgery in select population. And this benefit occurs very early after the procedure. And similarly, we find by echo, the TAVI valves perform much better than the surgical valve. Valve area is good, and the gradients also remain stable up to 2 years in this data set. So where do we stand with the intermediate group? Again, with intermediate group, we find that TAVI does better than surgery. Again, the benefit occurs very early at the procedure. The strokes are on the lower side. Also find that complications like major bleeding or acute kidney injury, new onset arrhythmias like atrial fibrillations are lower with TAVI. And the main plus point is the mean stay hospital is only about 3 days. But the problem with TAVI is that we don't have any long-term information about durability, how long this valves last. And again, the same data in pictorial format we find with PARTNER 2 as well as the core valve trial, we find that TAVI does perform either equal to or better than surgical valves. So this is the summary from the meta-analysis recently published. We again find that TAVI is superior to surgery in terms of all-cause mortality. So summarizing the evidence we've seen so far, TAVI has a lower rate, lower mortality, less arrhythmias, quicker recovery, better hemodynamics, and most importantly, no scar for some patients. So these are the guidelines for management of patients with severe aortic stenosis. Surgery is always a class 1 indication except for prohibitive surgical risk patients, whereas TAVI now is a class 1 indication for high risk and class 2A indication for patients with intermediate surgical risk. Now coming to low risk, is it possible to expand to TAVI to patients with low risk? With the data we have seen so far, it should be feasible. And this year in May, two trials were published. One was with the balloon expandable valve. The other one was with the self-expanding valve platform. These were two large randomized controlled trials. mean age was about 73 to 74 years, very low STS score, which means very low risk patients. And these were the baseline characteristics as well as the echocardiographic characteristics of this trial population. And these were the 1 year composite results, again showing superiority of TAVI over surgery, even in lower risk population. Again, the graphical picture representation of this about data, you can find that TAVR valve, especially with the balloon expandable valve, performs better than the surgical valve, and the benefit occurs very early after the surgical procedure. And again, the individual components of the composite primary endpoint, which is the death, stroke, and rehospitalization due to heart failure, TAVI performs better than the surgical valves. And secondary outcomes, major bleeding complications and acute kidney injury were again lower with TAVI valves, whereas newer pacemaker rates or new onset LVPP was slightly higher with the TAVI valves. TAVI valves tend to have a little bit of paravalvular regurgitation, but this tends to be mild and they do not have any clinical impact. Again, in the lower risk patients, the valve area as well as the valve gradients tend to do well at the end of 1 year. With self-expanding valve, we find similar results. Again, the same with the hemodynamic data. So all of these trials, actually, there were some limitations. One of the major limitations was that there was not much data available on durability. We don't know how long these valves will actually last. And there was no mention of entity called subclinical leaflet thrombosis. And it's important to know how long these valves last, because if you're going to put a valve in a patient who is like 50 or 60 years and this valve is going to last only 60 years, in his lifetime the patient would ultimately end up having two or three procedures. And there is a limit to number of TAVI procedures which can be done in a patient. And here you can see the data from a US population at somebody at 75 years has got a life expectancy of about 13 years. For a Indian population would be slightly lower. So you would want to have a valve which lasts at least 10 years or more. So other issue we talked about was subclinical leaflet thrombosis. We don't know the clinical impact of it, but we find a lot of studies coming up with rates as high as 40% in some valve series. So importantly, finally, which are the patients who should not get any TAVI procedure? These are the patients who are severely frail or who have severely demented. All other patients probably could benefit from a TAVI or a surgical valve replacement. Now, I just want to share some of our experience with TAVI at CMC. So we started this procedure way back in 2017. We deployed a self-expanding valve. And in the first week of November, we actually deployed a transpulmonary valve. This is the first time which we deployed here in the CMC. And you can see the pictures on the right side of the transcatheter pulmonary valve. So far we've done about 40 patients. We achieved procedural success in all patients. These were some of the pictures and videos of post-procedural angiographies. Again, you can see that there's no leakage of dye back into the ventricle, which means the valve is quite good and doing well. And these were the immediate outcomes. There were no procedural deaths, no major complication, no embolizations. Two patients required a pacemaker. There were two minor strokes in the group, and one patient required dialysis. And all patients had clinical improvement, with improvement in the valve area as well as the gradient. And even the biochemical parameter of PNP levels also reduced significantly. At 1 month follow-up, we again find the results are good. We now have follow-up of up to 1 year. Valves are doing well. There's no other additional complications or other events during follow-up period. These are the valve areas and valve gradient at 6 months and 1 year. They're all doing very fine. So just want to show you one case example of a typical TAVI patient and the procedure. This is an 80 plus year lady with all these comorbidities. She's come with class 3 angina and dyspnea. Angiogram shows minor coronary artery disease. 20 also get dimension of the vascular access vessels, and once we are discussed with our heart team, which involves surgeons and anesthesia, we plan for a TAVI, and this is how the TAVI procedure looks like. Again, the final result, valve is doing well, there's hardly any regurgitation. This is another case, rheumatic heart disease, who's had a mitral valve replacement in the past. Now he's got chronic kidney disease, he's got recurrent subdural hemorrhage, so he's actually a poor candidate for surgery. So this patient, we have managed to deploy a aortic valve while there was a mechanical valve present, and that is the final result. So in conclusion, what we have seen from the data so far, what we have learned from the data is that there is a strong evidence for TAVI for most age groups or most patient groups, but we need to have long-term data on durability, especially in younger patients. And every patient, we should be giving the option of surgery or TAVI. And then ultimately, it's a combined decision of patient, surgeon, and the cardiologist who make the decision for what each patient gets. So that ends my talk, and thank you all for, once again, thank you all for inviting me for this symposium.
I just have a few. The standard understanding about aortic stenosis, or particularly rheumatic aortic stenosis, was that it takes around 20 years for it to really organize into a stenosis. Stenosis occurs another 2-3 years later, they suddenly downhill course and rapid deterioration. Now, having this, how early the standard, the gradients, etc., no longer now applies, because the risk factor associated with this replacement must be much less.
Yes.
So, at what level of severity? So, what is your current understanding saying? When will you intervene? At yes. The earliest or?
No, so for the indications for treatment are clear. We again go by only by clinical as well as echocardiac severity. So which means that when your valve area is less than 1 or the mean gradient goes up more than 40, that is the stage where you intervene. And usually when you reach this stage, patient will develop some symptoms like at least a dyspnea or progressive reduction in effort tolerance. There are many patients you might miss out because they don't recognize the symptoms, because by the time they come with the symptoms, it's probably a bit late. But all patients who have got significantly reduced valve area or a gradient more than 40 are the ones which we will treat.
What about aortic regurgitation?
TAVI is not, as of now, TAVI is not an option for aortic regurgitation. The reason is that AR patients tend to have a very large annulus, and the current available valves do not, we don't get in those sizes usually. That is one point. Second point is you need a little bit of calcification for the valve to hold. So if you get a patient with a combined aortic stenosis or an AR, with a little bit of calcification, that could be an ideal candidate. But if there's a patient with pure AR, but not much of calcium, then we will not be able to offer TAVI. And surgery would be the standard.
Just one more question. In your 40 cases, you didn't find any particular problem. But in the literature, what is the degree of failure? And do you need to have a standby surgical team when you do this?
In general, we would need a standby surgical team because with the earlier generation valve, there were risk of valve embolization and things like annulus rupture during procedure. But with current generation valve, the risk of such events have come down drastically. But nevertheless, we want a surgical team on the backup.
Leave it open for questions.
The left yes. Ventricular hypertrophy yeah. that
occurs. It's reversible.
Is that it's reversible?
Yeah.
I have two little questions for you. One is, are you worried about infective endocarditis, para prosthetic infections? We do see that on occasion in Australia. And yeah. Number two, it's good to remember that contrast nephrotoxicity is not a big issue because enhanced cardiac output trumps everything.
Yeah. Yeah, so the first question, these patients are at increased risk of infective endocarditis. So we recommend IV prophylaxis for all patients post any prosthetic surgical or transcatheter. They will be advised infective endocarditis prophylaxis. During the procedure, we do give them antibiotic coverage. We keep it for at least 1 week post procedure. I mean, we don't have a guidelines per se, but so, yeah.
Just one more question. I understand around 80% of severe aortic stenosis is also associated with ischemic heart disease, coronary artery disease.
Yes.
Therefore, there's some kind of a coronary intervention is almost always necessary.
Yeah, so for most patients, if there is a, if they have coronary artery disease requiring interventions, we would treat them first. If the patient who is not a candidate for surgery, we would stent them.